you remain standing for our scripture lessons this morning that come from the book of Exodus, from Paul's letter to the people at Rome, and from the Gospel of John. First, from the book of Exodus, chapter 17, verses 3, 5, and 6. The people thirsted for water, and the people complained against Moses. The Lord said to Moses, "Strike the rock, and water will come out of it, so that the people may drink." And then from Romans 5, verses 1 and 2. Therefore, since we are justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ, through whom we have obtained access to this grace in which we stand. And then this story from John chapter 4, verses 5 through 15. So Jesus came to a Samaritan city called Sychar, near the plot of ground that Jacob had given to his son Joseph. Jacob's well was there, and Jesus, tired out by his journey, was sitting by the well. It was about noon. A Samaritan woman came to draw water, and Jesus said to her, "Give me a drink." His disciples had gone to the city to buy food. Now the Samaritan woman said to him, "How is it that you, a Jew, ask a drink of me, a woman of Samaria?" Jews do not share things in common with Samaritans. Jesus answered her, "If you knew the gift of God and who it is that was saying to you, 'Give me a drink,' you would have asked him, and he would have given you a gift of giving you living water." The woman said to him, "Sir, you have no bucket, and the well is deep. Where do you get that living water? Are you greater than our ancestor Jacob, who gave us the well and with his sons and flocks drank from it?" Jesus said to her, "Everyone who drinks of this water will be thirsty again. But those who drink of the water that I will give them will never be thirsty. The water that I will give will become a spring of water gushing up to eternal life." Jesus said to her, "Everyone who drinks of this water will be thirsty again, but those who drink the water that I will give will never be thirsty." The woman said to him, "Sir, give me this water so that I may never be thirsty or have to keep coming back here to draw water." This is the word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
You may be seated. Today we are continuing our series on looking for love. And you may remember that we started the series by talking about looking for the resister. And then last week we talked about looking for the helper. Well, today we're talking about looking for the thirst quencher. And our message today comes from this story that is one of my favorite stories in the Bible. And I know that for several of you, it is one of your favorite stories as well. But if you read all the lessons, the lessons from the Old Testament, the lesson from the Psalms, the lesson from Romans, if you read all of those lessons, you will discover that all of our lessons today are talking about thirst. And thirst is something that we all know. We've all experienced thirst. And in different countries, in different parts of the world, people deal with their thirst in different ways. Today we're going to be talking about drinking living water. And we're going to be talking about what does it take to recognize living water and what happens to us when we drink of living water. If you read the lesson from Exodus, you'll hear about how the Israelites were upset. You know, Moses had led them out of bondage in Egypt, and they were in the desert, and they had had it good in Egypt. Even though they were in slavery, they had three meals a day or something like that, and they had what they needed to drink and all of that. But now they were out in the desert, and they were angry at Moses because they were thirsty and they thought that they were going to die. In our gospel lesson today, we overhear this conversation between Jesus and this woman of Samaria, and Jesus is physically thirsty, and the woman is thirsty as well, but really her thirst is something different. We'll learn more about that in a second. It is a conversation about thirst, and Jesus offers to her streams of water that well up and well up to eternal life so that she will never be thirsty again. And then we read in Romans about how Jesus Christ is like an ever-flowing stream of love that comes into our lives and into our hearts. But I want to start out by talking about the fact that we are all thirsty. We all experience thirst, and we experience thirst of different sorts and different causes. it's become a phenomenon in recent years. You may have discovered it up and down the freeway and all kinds of places. There are all these coffee shops that are growing, and Starbucks is one of the fastest growing companies in our nation. And Starbucks is a place for coffee and also for conversation. For many folks, it's kind of like this well that the woman came to, this well that she came to draw water. But in Old Testament times and in New Testament time, the well in the village was a place where people would gather, and it was be a place not only to drink water, but also a place of conversation. Well, what they serve at Starbucks for high prices, though, is not something that really will take care of our thirst. It's not something that will assuage our thirst, because you see, the caffeine in the coffee does just the opposite. And when you combine the caffeine with the sugar in our vanilla lattes or our caramel macchiatos or our coffee mochas, when you put those two together, what it does is they conspire together to reduce the fluids in our body. One of the things that I know that our young people at Mission Bilby like to do is they like to drink soft drinks and anything with sugar in it. And the reality is that what we offer for thirst in America only guarantees that we will continue to be thirsty, because those things conspire together. They are natural diuretics, and what they do is they actually reduce the fluids in our body. The reality is we need to drink more and more and more. Well, our story today involves two characters, Jesus and a woman. And the story is, the setting is a well. And as I shared with you earlier, the well in those days was a community gathering place. It was a place where people went to draw water. I remember quite well, wasn't really intended to be a pun, but when I was in Haiti and when I was in Africa, one of the things about those communities is they had a common well. And everybody from the entire community would come to the well to draw water. And it was a community gathering place. It was a place where people talked. But most of the time when I was in Africa and when I was in Haiti, the times when people would come to gather water were early in the morning or late in the afternoon, about dusk. They would come because it was cooler then. And on this particular day, it is the middle of the day. It is about noon, and it is hot. And the only two people at the well are Jesus and this woman. And Jesus asked the woman for a drink of water. And a conversation ensues as they talk about it. And Jesus suggests that if she really knew who he was, she would be asking him for living water. Well, what I want to say to you is that this woman knew the value of a bucket. Now, I forgot to bring my bucket with me, but I had a bucket in the 9:30 service. If you can just imagine, I've got a bucket here. This woman knew the value of a bucket. You know what a bucket is. It's got a handle on it. You dip it down in the water, and you can carry water in it. And because you see, this woman responds to Jesus. She says to Jesus, "You have no bucket. You have no bucket, and the well is deep." And when she says this, she is making an accurate assumption of the realities as she understands them and as she sees, based on what she sees. Yes, Jesus had no bucket. Jesus had no bucket. There was nothing there with which Jesus could draw water with in the well. And what she is saying in a sense is this: the task before you is monumental. The task before you is monumental, and you don't have what you need. You don't have what you need to accomplish it. Jesus, you don't have a bucket. You don't have a bucket. How are you going to get water without a bucket? Well, what I want to say, like I have the tools to take care of what it is that's before me. I'm standing next to a deep well also with no bucket. I hear a voice in that situation when I'm facing that situation that exceeds my own human abilities to do what it is that I need to do. And perhaps that is your situation as well. Let me share with you a couple of situations that might be like something that you are facing. Maybe you've been given a task or a responsibility that you did not expect, and all of a sudden you're faced with this overwhelming sense of, I don't know how to do this. You ever been in a situation like that where you've been given a job or a responsibility and you just don't know that you have the tools to do what it is that you've been asked to do? You know what I'm talking about? You have a deep well before you, but you have no bucket. Maybe it's a loved one that is struggling with an addiction. It could be alcohol or something else, and you feel helpless. You just feel helpless. You don't have the tools that you need to help that person with that situation. The well is deep, and you have no bucket. You have no bucket. Maybe, I don't know if you feel this way, but sometimes as I am aware of all the issues in our community, in our neighborhood, here around the church and around Mission Milby, I'm aware of all kinds of situations of hurt and heartache and turmoil and all kinds of situations. And as I think about those situations, sometimes I feel like I just do not have the tools that I need to help in all those situations. You may feel that way too. It's a deep well, but we have no bucket. That's what the woman said to Jesus at the well. You have no bucket, and the well is deep. But who is this one that is sitting next to her at the well? Isn't this Jesus? Isn't this Jesus? Isn't this the one who can quench that thirst within her? What I want to say to you this morning is that this story reminds us that when we stand beside a well that is deep and we have no bucket, Jesus stands there right with us. Jesus always stands beside us. This is one of several gospel stories in the Gospel of John that Alan Culpepper, who's a New Testament scholar, calls recognition scenes. Recognition scenes are those scenes in the gospel where people are given the opportunity to recognize Jesus, or they actually do recognize Jesus as the Son of God. And there are many such encounter scenes in the gospel. Jesus has interchanges with the religious authorities. Jesus also goes and talks to the invalid who is laying next to the pool at Bethsaida. And then there are the crowds, and then there are the disciples individually and as a group. And then there is the woman caught in adultery. And then there are Peter and James and John and Mary and Martha and Lazarus and the high priest and Pilate. All of these situations in the Gospel of John are what you might call recognition scenes. They give the people, the characters in the story, the opportunity to see and understand Jesus for who Jesus is. They give them the opportunity to recognize Jesus as the Son of God, the Word made flesh. And they are also given the opportunity to share the good news with others. Now, in some of the cases, they do like the woman in this scene. What does she do? Our call to worship said she became the first evangelist, and that's exactly right. She went out and told people about who Jesus was and how he had changed her life. But then there are some others, like the high priest and the crowds, who just don't recognize Jesus for who Jesus is. Last week, we read the story of Nicodemus, and Nicodemus was the one who came to see Jesus in the middle of the night. He knew that there was something special about Jesus, but he did not want anybody to know that he had recognized that. The thing that stands in the way of most of us recognize Jesus is the tendency to only look as deep as appearances. The woman saw Jesus there standing without a bucket. How could he draw water without a bucket? When we stay at a literal level in looking at the scriptures, and we stay at a literal level looking at the stories of the gospels, we don't get it totally. We don't understand it. We often do not understand. But look at the questions. The questions that we read in these stories. We have the questions that came out of the story of Nicodemus. We had the questions that came from the woman at the well. We have the questions of the man at the pool. Last week we heard Nicodemus say, "How can you be born again? Do you go back into the womb a second time?" This week we also had the question this woman who just didn't understand what living water was. Then there's the man at the pool of Bethsaida who is laying beside the pool and he says, "I have no one to put me in the water so that I can be healed." All the while, Jesus is standing there next to him. The healer is standing there next to him. With Nicodemus, Jesus is talking about something totally different than being born out of the womb a second time. Jesus is talking about a new birth that wells up from within through the Holy Spirit. When the invalid is by the pool, Jesus is talking about the healer, the healing that comes from God, not the sporadic bubbling that comes up from a hot spring. When Jesus is talking about living water, Jesus is talking about a spiritual sustenance that you do not need a bucket to receive. That kind of sustenance is available to any person when we stand beside a well with a deep, deep, when we stand beside a deep, deep well without a bucket. The situation of the woman is difficult. She faces a situation to try to regain her identity, and the task seems too large for her. So she comes to the well in the middle of the day. She comes to the well in the middle of the day at the hottest time of the day to avoid the derision of others, and she has three strikes against her in talking to a Jewish man. She's a woman, she's from Samaria, and she has a difficult past she's trying to clear up. And still, Jesus talks to her and offers her living water. What is that? It's a relationship with God that Jesus says that she can have through him. It's a relationship that will restore her dignity in the community. Jesus recognizes her limitations and her weaknesses. And Jesus offers her living water by offering to stand beside her. And that's the way it is with us as well. When we find ourselves in one of those places where we have a monumental task facing us, Jesus stands there beside us. He sits beside our deepest wells, and he places himself in the midst of our situations. He is the bread of life and the living water and the light of the world and the gate and the good shepherd. And Jesus is right there next to us in the heat of the day and at the height of our fatigue. And as we stand beside deep wells without a bucket, Jesus is there to offer us the spiritual sustenance that we need in those difficult situations. So I want to encourage you to let the woman's prayer be your prayer. The woman's prayer is printed there in your bulletin, in your Grove Green study guide, off to the left as a part of our prayer for the week. And we're going to pray that at the end of the service, but before we do that, I want to tell you the story of an American educator and the story that he told. Booker T. Washington was an African-American educator, and he told this story about how there were two ships in the South Atlantic, and they were off the coast of South America, and these two ships were signaling back to each other. The first ship signaled to the other ship, "Help! Save us! Or we perish for lack of water." And the other ship sent a message back, "Cast down your buckets. Cast down your buckets where you are." gotten the message just right, and so they sent the message back. The troubleship sent the message back again. Help, save us, or we perish for lack of water. Help, save us, or we perish for lack of water. And again, the other ship signaled back, cast down your buckets where you are. Well, the exchange went on back and forth for several times, and finally, the troubled ship, the ship without water, decided, well, we have nothing else to do other than follow this crazy advice. And so the crew members cast down their buckets into the ocean. They cast their buckets down to the ocean, and as they drew their buckets up, they were full of clear, sparkling, cool, fresh water. What they had not realized is that the powerful current of the Amazon River carried fresh water from the South American rainforest way out into the Atlantic Ocean, many miles out into the South Atlantic. And they could cast their buckets down into that stream and pull up fresh, clear water. And so the woman's prayer is our prayer, isn't it? She said to Jesus, "Sir, give me this water so that I may never be thirsty or have to keep coming here again." It is a prayer that has been answered even before it's uttered. And so when you stand at a well, a deep well, a momentous task before you without a bucket, I hope that you will pray this prayer. In fact, I invite you to take out your Grow, Pray, Study Guide. There at the bottom of your Grow, Pray, Study Guide on the left, you'll find the prayer of the woman. And I invite you to use this prayer this week when you face those monumental tasks that just seem so overwhelming, and you don't feel like you have the buckets that you need to do what you have to do. You don't have the tools that you need to accomplish what you have before you. When you feel that way, I invite you to pray this prayer. Let's pray together. Lord God, the source of my strength, help me reach down into the depths of your being. Give me your living water that I may never be thirsty again or have to keep coming back to draw more water. In the name of Jesus Christ, the source of all living water. Our closing hymn this morning is "Open My Eyes."